Good morning. Welcome to Prescott Church of the Nazarene. Come on in, have a seat. Let's get this on the road. Let's get started. Let's worship our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So let's go ahead and roll the video, the announcements, please.
Well, Spaghetti in Spring is Saturday, April 13th from 5 to 7 p.m. with $7 a ticket. There's a homemade dinner, large silent auction, door and table prizes. And all proceeds are going to help our teens attend NYC 2019. We have something else, new addition to the Spaghetti in Spring auction.
And that is this guitar. It's been signed by over 20 Christian music artists. And we'll be doing a live auction for this great collector's item. Spaghetti in Spring is Saturday, April 13th from 5 to 7 p.m., $7 per ticket. Delegates are needed to serve and attend the District Assembly and the NMI Convention June 6, 7, and 8. So circle D on your Connect card if you'd like to attend. The Tenebrae service is the service of shadows on Good Friday, April 19th at 6 p.m. Join us for this great service. Women's Book Club meets Thursday, April 4th at 9:30 a.m. in the conference room. The book for discussion is Mostly Sunny by Janice Dean. A new study, Women of the Bible, begins Monday, April 8th at 1 p.m. If you'd like to attend, call Becky Jaco at 928-379-3728 or contact the church office. We would love to have your photo in our directory. All you need to do is snap a pic and email it to the office and we'll make sure you're included. Ushers are needed, and if you'd like to be an usher, please circle U on your Connect card and drop it in the offering plate. Warm for Winter is now being administrated by our church. We're collecting coats and jackets all year long until the distribution days in October 17th and 19th. Don't forget to fill out a Prescott Nazarene Connect card if you're visiting with us or you'd like to update your information, place it in the offering plate. But don't forget, on the back of the card is a place for your prayer request. And know that we will be praying for all of them. If during the service you have need of assistance, today's emergency team are Jack Brizendine and Cody Gates. Everyone loves a hot cup of coffee. And if you're wanting one right now, you'll have to circle K because we serve ours before service. Now let's prepare our hearts to worship the King of Kings.
All right, everybody, let's stand and get ready to glorify the Lord as we worship him this morning. At some point, they will start the count off, so I know where we are. There it is. Father, we want to come into your presence this morning in all seriousness, but also with all joy, because you're such a great and good God. And to declare that goodness and know that you sent your Son for us. Come on, let's say, Lord, you are good, you are good. When there's nothing good in me, you are love on display for all to see. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. Yes, you have, Lord. You're peace to me. You are peace when my fear is crippling. You are true, you are true.
Even in my wandering, you are light, you are joy. You're the reason that I sing. You are life, you are life. In you death has lost its sting. To your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. Lord, you are more, you are more than my words will ever say. You are Lord, all creation will proclaim. You are here, in your presence I'm made whole. You are God, of all else I'm letting go.
Love in the dead of night and eternity.
I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. When I see many searching for answers far and wide, but I know that we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Lord, you are
perfect in all of your ways.
Yes, Lord.
You are perfect. All of your ways, you are perfect in all of your ways to us.
So much grace, Lord.
You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to
undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me, Lord.
Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
You're a good, good Father. It's who you are.
It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am.
Yes, Lord.
It's who I am.
Thanks to you, Lord.
It's who I am. You're a good, good Father.
It's who you are. It's who you are. Yeah.
It's who you are. And I'm loved by you.
It's who I am.
It's who I am.
It's who I am.
You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
It's your goodness. Your faithfulness, oh Lord, you're a good, good Lord. Bless your name this morning. Holy Spirit, rain down. Rain down. Oh, comforter. How we need your touch again. Now, Holy Spirit, rain down.
Yes, Lord.
Rain down.
Now, let your power fall.
Lord, let your voice be heard. Come and change our hearts as we stand on your word. Holy Spirit, reign
now. Holy Spirit, reign. Like you do, and it's why you satisfy our souls. You are enough, and we bless you this morning for being everything we need. You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul with your love. Yes, you satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul with your love. You make my heart sing. You lift me on eagle's wings. Just when I thought that my heart it would fade. And you take the darkest night and you turn it to shining light. Just when I thought that the night had won, Lord, you satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul with your love.
That's why we sing hallelujah to the Lord.
Oh, hallelujah. You make all things beautiful. Lord, hallelujah. Trials and testing prove this gold. Oh, hallelujah. You turn mourning into joy.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. Oh, you make all things beautiful.
I will sing hallelujah.
For trials and testing prove this gold.
Oh, hallelujah.
You turn mourning into joy.
You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul with your love. Every day remind us, Lord.
You satisfy my soul, Lord. You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul with your love.
And you make my heart sing. You lift me on eagle's wings.
Just when I thought that my heart, it would fade.
And you take the darkest night,
you turn it to shining light. Just when I thought that the night had gone.
Lord, you satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul with your love.
Oh, you satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul with your love.
Lord, you satisfy like nothing else. And I think in all of our lives we've tried other things, and when we come to Christ, we understand there's no one like you, and no one can satisfy our souls, our hearts like you do. So Lord, as we prepare with the choir right now to proclaim all creatures of our God and King, would give praise to the King of Kings. We bless you for that. Thank you for all you do in our lives. In Jesus' name, everyone said,
amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Something for us today, and I need kids to come up. Ooh, good job. You're the first one up here. All right. Come on up. Come on up. All right. Now, we're going to see if you've been paying attention. Do you recognize this box?
Yes.
Lost and found. This is our lost and found. Come on up. You guys are doing awesome. Just come on in and find yourself a seat. You guys, there's spots right up here. Perfect. This is our lost and found box. And this is a fabulous box because about every 6 months, I get to go in here and find out what kind of awesome stuff needs a home. Because everything in here belongs to somebody. Every item, there's some child who looks at and goes, oh, I love this. So, I haven't been through this for a while. Should we go in and see what we've got today?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's see what we've got in here today. Aha, I suspect this doesn't belong to any of you. It's a pacifier.
No.
Belong to any of you? No. Okay, so we're probably safe, kind of, that is a baby's, you're right. We're kind of safe. I'm going to hand that to Quentin. That's not for you. Just kind of hang on to that. All right. Ooh, let's see what this one is. This one's kind of nice. It's a hat. Belong to any of you? Does that belong to you? Or you just really like it? You just really like it, yeah. This is cool. This is perfect because that's part of our message, okay? Because sometimes we really like things, yeah, but maybe that's not what we should belong to. So let's do that. Ooh, let's see what else we've got. How about jacket? Huh? Nobody, yeah. There's some child somewhere who really likes this jacket. Yeah, and would probably be really happy if they found it. Let's try for one more thing and see if we can find it's who it belongs to. How about nobody? Okay, this thing's cool because I would like to have this. Okay, this is you too. This is lost and found. Now, the interesting thing about all of this is that each item in here belongs to somebody, and it's kind of like us. Did you know that we all belong to somebody? Who do we belong to? To God and to our parents. You're right. Yeah. Who do you belong to? Yeah, these are kind of tricky questions. Yeah, you're right. That is who you belong to. Okay. And the answer I was looking for today, just so you know, it was that usual Sunday school answer. We belong to God. But sometimes we can get lost, just like the things, just like the water bottle and the jacket and the pacifier and the really cool hat. Sometimes, is that actually yours? Mm-hmm. Okay, sometimes we get lost. And when we do, it's kind of like we're trapped inside of that lost and found box. Yeah, but that one that we belong to, just like Byron said, God comes seeking us and he comes looking for us, because it doesn't matter if we've been lost for just a few minutes or if we've been lost for 6 months like the things in here, or if we've been lost for years, God comes and he keeps looking for us and seeking us, and he's calling us, and he's doing it to everybody in here. He's saying, oh, I want you just a little bit more than you're already here. Just come a little closer, come a little closer. Okay, so I'm going to give you guys a challenge today. Byron, I'm going to ask you just to hold your question for a couple minutes, okay? Okay, I'm going to give you a challenge. And usually I give you a challenge for a whole week. This time I'm giving you a challenge for like 1 hour. In a few minutes, Pastor Ira is going to come up here and he's going to talk to us about some stuff. Okay, he is going to talk to us about God. Okay, and when he starts talking to us, it's going to relate to this lost and found box in some way. And I want you guys to listen. Okay, and I want you to think, oh, I get it. And then you come and find me afterwards, and I want you to tell me how what he tells us today relates to everything that is in this lost and found box. You think you can handle that? Okay, so here's what I need you to do. I've got 10 of you who are going to stay right where you're at. You know who you are. Everybody else, I need you to stand up and go back to mom, dad, whoever. Yep, so you get to go back. And Abby, you get to go back. Good job. Now the rest of you guys get to follow me, and we are gonna take our lost and found box and we're going to the back of the sanctuary because we got something good coming. All right, thank you guys.
Love that we have the transition from the children to what we're going to do really quick here. I'm going to have Cheyenne come up here, and she is heading off in a week to basic training with the U.S. Air Force. So We have got to surround her as a community in prayer, of course. So I'm going to have Amanda lead us in prayer for her. But we need to be a people that are remembering her over the next course of, 12 weeks? 8.5 weeks for you? Yeah. Over the next 8.5 weeks. But really, this next transition, she's getting thrown into the real midst of it, right? Keep the faith. Be strong. This is where it's at. This is really in the trenches. And isn't that great to go from children's moment to this is where it ends up. This is, man, watch them grow up fast and be in the church. And let's just keep on being the people surrounding them in prayer. All right.
Let's pray. Father God, we just come before you and we praise you for Cheyenne, who she is, and this next thing that she's participating in. God, I pray for peace in her decision. I pray for peace in the midst of chaos, in the midst of new places and unknown. God, I pray that you would give her clarity, give her focus and motivation, God, but that you would also be a place she can come, a safe place. God, I pray that the things she has learned growing up, God, would become tangible and real, and the God that you are would be so evident to her in the midst of this next chapter of her life. God, I ask for you to move in mighty ways, that you would provide community, that you would just strengthen her when she feels weak. God, I praise you that your grace is sufficient, and that doesn't promise, you know, perfect magic, instant things to happen, but that every step you give her strength to take one more and one more. God, I just pray that you would be at work. We give her to you, and we trust you, God. We love you in your name. Amen.
I just take my pulpit with me everywhere I go. It's just always there. I think I'd get a lighter one if I took it beyond this building. We want to continue to be in prayer for people in our church that are going through times of loss. Don't forget all those that have lost loved ones in the last year. It's quite a list. I hope you'll be in prayer for them. Remember to talk to them about the person they lost. Don't ever be afraid to mention their names, because they think about them on a daily and a regular basis. So that's important. Phil McCullough was not with us today on a keyboard because his daughter-in-law, Heather, passed away this past Monday, and that was after a 7-year-long battle with cancer. And so Phil's son, and Sheila's son Wesley, is now with Jackson, their 3-year-old son. And so it's going to need to be a tough time of transition. So Phil and Sheila are there, and I think Wesley and Jackson are going to come back here and spend a little bit of time with them. But I hope you'll be in prayer for Phil and Sheila and Farine and all the family, her parents, and just they're in Michigan. So they'll be back this week, but keep them in your thoughts and prayers. And then I want to let you know that this coming Saturday is a memorial service for Bill Backus. And Bill is Charlotte Scheibel's dad. Mike and Charlotte are here, part of our church. And Bill attended church here for a couple of years. And then due to dementia, Alzheimer's, he was unable to attend. And they had him in their home and were caregivers. But I hope you'll be remembering their family. And if you're able to come and be with us this coming Saturday as we remember him and as we also just share the gospel and worship together, sing some hymns, read some scripture, and celebrate the fact that there is a resurrection. And we have a hope that the world does not have. And we don't approach death the same way that the world does. We have a great hope and a great promise through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So I just invite you to pray with me, and then we'll receive our offering. Our children are going to help out today with the offering. We're trying to incorporate Make Family Sundays, as you can tell, a time when they can experience and watch and participate and be a part of everything that we're doing. And drop in your Connect card. We'd love to know how to pray for you. And of course, bring your offering and offer yourself to Him today. Father, we come and offer ourselves to You. All that that means, all that consumes our lives right now, our concerns, our anxieties, for we know You are a good, good Father, and You love us, and You care for us. I pray that before this day is over, before we walk out these doors in a few minutes, we'll be impacted by the good news of the gospel, that we serve a loving, caring God. You love us. Nothing can separate us from Your love. Nothing. So break through whatever is a barrier, whatever's going on in our minds or our hearts that might cause us not to believe that. And we come to offer ourselves in a fresh and new way this day. We know we can surrender anything that's touching our lives because You're a just and a loving God. And we ask this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Pastor just said that God needs to break through the walls. And sometimes the walls are our own wisdom, our own form of wisdom. We think we know what life is all about. We think we know the answers to religion and all that. And Jesus is who He said He was. It's okay to question. It's okay to have all your questions and to dig and to find out what it's all about. In Philippians 2, the Bible tells us that we have to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling before the Lord. But we have to come to that place where it's our own. And sometimes we come to the wrong conclusion. So we're gonna, in the song, we're gonna play one side and the other. Okay, here we go. What if you're right? And he was just another nice guy. What if you're right? What if it's true? They say the cross will only make a fool of you. What if it's true? What if he takes his place in history with all the prophets and the kings who taught us love and came in peace? But then the story ends. What then? But what if you're wrong? What if there's more? What if there's hope you never dreamed of hoping for? What if you jump and just close your eyes? What if the arms that catch you by surprise? What if he's more than enough? What if it's love? What if you dig way down deeper than your simple-minded friends? What if you dig? What if you find a thousand more unanswered questions deep inside?
What if you find?
That's all you find. What if you pick apart the logic and begin to poke the holes? What if the crown of thorns is no more than folklore that must be told and retold? But what if you're wrong? What if there's more? What if there's hope you never dreamed of hoping for?
If you would jump and just close your eyes, what if the arms that catch you by surprise? What if he's more than enough? What if it's love? You've been running as fast as you can. You've been looking for a place you can land for so long. But what if you're wrong? What if you jump and just close your eyes? What if the arms that catch you by surprise? What if he's more than enough? What if it's love? What if it's love?
Well, this is the fourth Sunday of Lent. I don't know if you're counting. There are six that lead us up to Easter Sunday. But we've been using this devotional book called For God So Loved. It's been an amazing read. Some of you have been giving some feedback to me about what you've been learning, and I hope it's helped you prepare for each Sunday morning. And we all know maybe where For God So Loved came from. Anybody hear of John 3:16? Everybody see it on a sign or a bumper sticker? Sometimes we don't read verse 17 of that passage, but this is what 3:16 says. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. So think about that, to save it. Our purpose as a church isn't to condemn the world, but to be working where God is working in the world. And that's what we looked at last Sunday. And this Sunday morning, we're going to look at what is a very familiar story from Luke chapter 15. If you have a chance today, you might just read the Gospel of Luke chapter 15. There are a lot of parables there. But Jesus was being criticized because he wasn't condemning the world, and he was hanging out with people that they thought he shouldn't be hanging out with, because he was on a mission to reconcile them to his heavenly Father. And so I want to read to you a portion of that, Luke 15, chapter 15, verses 1 through 3. It says, now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. Then Jesus told them this parable. And there are a number of parables. I'm going to only read you the one that's found down there in verse 11. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided the property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and squandered his wealth in wild living. Verse 14, after he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. for I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and he went to his father. This is my favorite part. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. And it's like the father almost holds up his hands and interrupts him. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he is found. So they began to celebrate. I hope you know that that's why we gather here on Sundays primarily, is to celebrate. The kingdom of God is a party. Not like the world's party, but it's a party. Meanwhile, and this is what some of us do, the older son was in the field, and when he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants, and he asked him what was going on. And the older brother became angry and refused to go in. What a powder. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who squandered your property with prostitute comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him. My son, the father said, you are always with me. Everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours, notice that, this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he's found. Now, this is a well-known story. It is a well-known story. If you haven't read it, I'm glad you're hearing it for the first time, but I'm just here to tell you that this story is displayed in paintings hung in the most prestigious art museums around the world. It's been retold in every form possible, from novels to Veggie Tales. Do you guys know what that is? That's Larry the Cucumber. I used to call him Larry the Pickle and Bob the Tomato. I mean, that's where you really know it's well known. It's been retold by vegetables. The dangers of stories that become so familiar, though, to us is that we tend to look at them in the same way with the same eyes, and we tend to approach them with the same biases. Yes, you and I all approach the Bible sometimes with our own biases, and we come away from them with the same misunderstandings. And even if this story is retold by a cartoon cucumber and his tomato friend, we still often see the story the same way. There's several ways that we've looked at it. I think probably the most basic way, when we read the story, we think about the prodigal, the young son, that disrespectful. Maybe you don't even look at it. Maybe you say, that is me. Maybe you identify with the prodigal. Maybe you're thinking of somebody right now. And we tend to view the story by focusing on the prodigal. We tell it, we understand it as the story of a son who left the riches of his father and basically told him he wished he were dead and went out and lived wild. I mean, we get a little glimpse into it. Prostitutes are mentioned in there. Not supposed to say that word on Family Sunday, but prostitutes were mentioned. All kinds of things going on, everything you could probably imagine he was into. And when he ended up with the pigs, and you got to remember, right? For a Jewish boy to hang around pigs and to take care of pigs was way out there. I mean, this is something you just did not do. And then in desperation, he literally wants to eat what the pigs eat. And he's forced to return home. So maybe that's the way you've always viewed the story. Maybe you identify with the prodigal. Maybe you're thinking of your own child or someone you know, and that's where you really focus. But another way to look at it, and I've always liked this, this is my favorite. I like it as the story of the two lost sons, because they're both lost. One's lost close to home, one's lost far away. And I just can't tell you that. I think that's my prejudice because I've been a pastor for so many years, and I'm the kid who stayed home. I've been that kid. I'm the church kid. I'm the pastor. I'm the one who's been in church and done all of this. And then I think pastoring, this is the one where I just like to give it to the church, you know, and get onto the church and correct their attitude. So I tend to look too much maybe at this part of it. But if you don't know how that works, let me preach it a little bit. The older son is just as lost as the younger son, even though he's close to home. The older son is more responsible, but he's jealous of the grace given to his reckless younger brother. Now, by the way, I'm the baby of the family, so I don't get that part. But all you older children, you're thinking of the younger children. I know you are. And this older son, he stands outside the party, and he demands his rights. That's just a great picture of us when the church misses its mission. And I can't tell you how many times as a pastor I've seen people in the church stand outside the party and just rave against the real mission of what the Father is. But I think the greatest tragedy is while he stayed home and helped manage the property, he didn't have his father's heart. He did not have his father's heart. While he was so close to the Father and so responsible, so faithful, and there all the time, he didn't have his father's heart. He was supposed to be representing his father. But there's a whole other way to tell this story. And I think that is to focus on the father rather than the sons. And that's what I want you to do this morning. I know I reminded you about the two boys, but I want you to forget them for a moment. I want us to let go of how we've heard the story in the past. And I want you just to focus on the father rather than the sons, because the father in the story represents God the Father. And that's the person we need to focus on this morning. I don't care if you're the prodigal or you're the eldest or you're none of them. I want us to focus on the Father, because God is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond anything I can ask or think. And it's a story of a prodigal father. You go, you can't use that word about the father. Yes, I can, because prodigal means extravagant, lavish, unrestrained. You always think about that in the terms of evil, right? You know, the person who just went off the deep end and they're out there living this wild life. But I want you to think about it as a descriptor of the father in this story. He could be even considered to be wasteful as a father. He could be considered to just be over the top. Watch the father in the story with me. What if instead of looking at the story and focusing on the prodigal son, defining it by the ways the son has failed, by the ways he's been selfish, the things he has squandered, and what he has lost are on the two brothers, one defined by recklessness, the other by jealousy. What if instead we look at this as the story of the loving father? Watch the father in this story. Rivet your attention on him. Observe his actions and his reactions. Listen to him. Feel his heartbreak. The spotlight is never off the father in the story. He's at center stage. And the moment the curtain goes up, the two sons are just supporting actors, okay? That's the way we're gonna look at it. And as I watched the father in this story, here's what I learned about him. The father is generous. We'd probably say generous to a fault. The younger son, like I said, basically told his dad, I wish you were dead. I would rather have your money and your land than you around. Now, that's a painful thing for any dad to hear, I would imagine. And asking for one's inheritance, even in that day, was like saying, I'd be better off without you here. You're a pain. You're old. Move on. I would prefer your money rather than you. And it was the expectation in that culture that the Jewish men would control their estate while they were alive. It would have been shameful for an heir, any heir, to request his inheritance prior to his father's death. And while shameful for the son to ask for his inheritance early, it would have been just as shameful, if not more so, for the father to actually give the inheritance. I mean, everybody was going, what are you thinking? When they're hearing this story, they're going, what is this father thinking? That's just ridiculous. It's scandalous. Nobody should do that. It might be in rare cases the father might divide his land for his sons to manage while he was still alive. But it would be the father's choice, and it would not be the children's place to ever, ever ask for it. And the story never says the father asked the intention of the son. Do you notice that? Well, son, can you give me a business plan and tell me what you're going to do with this money? How are you going to spend it? I want an accounting back for what you're going to do with it. He knew what the son was going to do with it, right? How many of you have kids? You raised them. You know how they spend. They start sometime from an early age. I have, you know, I got to be careful, but I had one daughter. When we'd go to SeaWorld, she would buy the first thing she saw, and she wanted it right then. Boom, it was over. And the other one, she looked at everything. She ran calculations before she would spend the money. You know, that's just the difference in kids. And you know, even with your own children, he knew what he was going to do. And despite that, knowing probably where it was poured out, he gives it to him. Think about that. Radical generosity, scandalous. It's scandalous. Grace is always scandalous. Giving people what more than they deserve? The father is just and compassionate. Even though the younger son has squandered everything and he's starving to death, the son still longs to even be one of his father's well-cared-for servants. The father's servants are fed, even though it's during famine. He's sure of it. The son knows his father probably would go without to take care of the people who work for him. He'll be well cared for. It implies the father isn't cruel. He isn't unkind. Some of us would never have wanted to work for our father. Anybody like that? This kid goes, I'd love to work for my dad. He treats his people too well. He's good. He's gracious. I'm going to go home. I'd be better off as one of my dad's servants than in this place where I'm at with the pigs. And verse 20 says it all. Oh, I love this verse. When he came to his senses, he got up and he went to his father. And while he was still a long way off, and I may be talking to somebody who's a long way off this morning, I want you to hear this. A long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. And compassion is a strong word. In the original language, it means to be moved to the very core of one's being and to act in love toward the son. And the compassion caused the father to run toward his son. And we're not given an indication of how old the father was, but the son was gone for years and the dad probably was old. Now, I know old then may not be what old is now. I am an old man. I don't care how old you are. A lot of you are a lot older than me. And you keep telling me that I'm young, but I am old. And I feel my oldest when I do races. When I line up with sometimes all these 20-year-olds and 30-year-olds and 40-year-olds and now 50-year-olds, and there's less and less of us alive to still toe the line and try to do the race. And when they do the awards at the end, if you ever make the podium, there's nobody left except really old people to get there. Because there's no, only way I make the podium is everybody was dead but me. And when I do run, it looks strange. I know this because I've been running in the city before down in Mesa, and a kid saw me running toward him, and he looked at me when I ran by, and he said, what are you doing? You can't tell. I said, I'm running. One time I was doing a triathlon in Lake Havasu, And we had run up over the London Bridge, like 30 stairs, and we ran on this peninsula, and we were running back. And they had kids at the aid stations, and I ran by one of the aid stations. And one of these kids looked at the other kid after I ran by, and he goes, "That guy was really old." I'm so old that animals attack me because it's pack instinct, because they call the old elk from the herd. Right? Poodles attack me. Chihuahuas attack me. Labradoodles, and that gets serious. Don't mess with a labrador. Those big, giant, poodle-looking things. And I know it's because they sense they're smelling me, and they know he's about dead. Let's take him out. He'll be an easy one to take down. So this old Jewish dad here, he's not wearing running shorts or stretchy pants. He's got robes down around his ankles, and all Jewish men did not run. He probably had to gather them up and run. And I have grandchildren now. They want me to run and play soccer, and then they laugh at me when I try. But he didn't care, because he had compassion. Huh. I don't know if you've ever had the experience of not seeing a child for a while and longing. Maybe they're back from deployment. Maybe they're back from college. But I have this memory when my firstborn went to college, and she was gone for a long time, and I grieved over her leaving, and I it was so hard. I just like, what's happening to my world? And I really struggled with it. But I got to go see her over at Point Loma Nazarene University. And at Point Loma, they have I don't even know what they call it. It's a path. It's all brick that runs down by the student center, or whatever they call it now, the CAF and all that stuff down there. And I walked up that to meet her. I spotted her. She was a long ways off. I picked her out of the crowd. You ever meet them at the airport? You know, and everybody stands watching them come up the ramp, the gates, and you see them. You can't run to them because they'll arrest you if you run past that. But you feel this. That's my baby. That's my kid. And this is powerful. This is a powerful picture. The father saw him. And the only way he would have saw him is that he was looking for him day after day after day. And while we don't know how long it takes the son to blow through the money and come to the place of desperation, I know it was a long time. And even if it wasn't for years, the loss of a son and the grief that can cause to a good and loving parent would have felt like a lifetime. Yet he kept looking. The father's forgiving. See, the son doesn't even finish his speech. I'm sure this son went over and over in his head again, "This is what I would do. And this is what I'm going to say to dad when I get there. I know my dad, but I'm going to say this. And I've got it all in my head, and I'm going to present it." You ever have a speech you're going to present, and then somebody won't let you finish it? And he says, I got to say this. I'm going to say this to my dad. And he doesn't even get it out. He doesn't even finish his speech until he puts a ring on his finger and a robe on his shoulders. Claims him as his son, and he doesn't ask where he was and where the money is and how he ended up smelling like pigs. He just welcomes him home. The wanderings of the prodigal son are never once mentioned by the father. The father in this story is the one who loves deeply. The response of the son coming home is a party. You've got to remember that. It's a party. It's a celebration. It includes food and dancing and celebration. And it's still during the famine. How did he pull that off? I mean, he may have just had a little bit left, but he goes, "It doesn't matter. My son is home. We're going to celebrate with extravagance." And then this is loving. He doesn't allow the older brother to ruin the party. That's loving. And it's loving that he took the time to go out and talk to him, and he invites him in.
He reminds him that he loves him too. I mean, it's a powerful story. Even if we're pouting outside, manning our rights, not understanding, even if we're off wasting things, this is the way God cares for you. Whether you're the prodigal or you're the eldest or you're somewhere in between, this is how God cares for you. Despite our failings, God is generous, right? God is just, and we can trust him. We can trust him with everything. We can trust him with our money. We can trust him with our health. We can trust him with our kids. Oh, there's a tough one. We can trust him. We can trust him. We can stop holding on and trying to control everything and demand our rights and keep it all together. We can trust him. He's a good, good father. God is patient with us. We fail time and time again, yet God continually watches and waits for us. Oh, there's a Jesuit priest, I forget his name right now, that I followed that works with gangs in inner city LA. And he says, God waits. Who am I not to wait? And if you quit waiting for somebody to come back or to come to Christ, we don't have our Father's heart. You see what I mean? He waits. He's patient. He seeks us out while he waits for us. He meets us along the road. If you read the rest of the chapter, Luke 15, he'll travel any distance to find us. He forgives. He doesn't bring up our past misdeeds, but forgives and forgets. And he loves extravagantly. We are celebrated. Some of you say, I've never been celebrated. You are celebrated. And if you're far away from God and you come back, all heaven rejoices. I mean, they take a whole day off and have a party in heaven. I'd love to work in heaven, wouldn't you? Oh, let's have a party. Another 10 people. Yeah, let's have a party. We don't need to live in the shame of our past. I don't know what your past is. God knows your past, but he's not going to bring it back up to you. The enemy does. The enemy of your soul does. You don't need to live in jealousy over the grace you see bestowed upon others. I still think it's unfortunate that the thief on the cross did not have to go to church four times a week and miss Bonanza as a kid. He makes it at the last minute. Do you realize how wrong that is? I was drugged to church, beaten church, made to go to church. I'm not saved by works. I was blessed to be in church. I was blessed. And if some dear soul in the last moment of their life comes to faith in Christ, that is the God I serve. And I can't have the attitude of the eldest son that they don't get in because it's just not fair. No, it's not fair. And it's not fair you made it in. I can't be jealous. We can rest in the promises that we follow a God of deep compassion, love, and forgiveness. So we can walk toward God as God runs toward us with an embrace of comfort and compassion. We don't even need to finish our speech of contrition. I remember being in a church service as a teenager, and I had sinned that week in so many ways, and God convicted me, and I was repenting, and I got to go to the altar. And a pastor didn't give an altar call. You realize they don't have to give an altar call for you to be forgiven. That's really a new invention. It really is. It's only a few hundred years old. Came out of revivalist meetings. You don't have to. I'm going to keep offering them at times. But anytime you turn to God in confession, he'll interrupt you. And the forgiveness flows. Because it's in your heart where the turning happens. It's amazing, isn't it? He's a good father who loves us with complete abandon and is just waiting for us to see approach home. And so this is why I'm convinced, like it says in Romans 8, I'm convinced with Paul that neither death nor life, angels nor demons, the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So we come this morning to receive the Eucharist, the Lord's Supper. The communion supper instituted by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is a sacrament. It proclaims his life, his sufferings, his sacrificial death, his resurrection, the hope of his coming again. The Lord's Supper is a means of grace. In other words, Christ is present here by the Spirit. And listen to this. All are invited to participate by faith in Christ and be renewed in life. Anybody need renewed in life this morning? Salvation. Unity as the church. All are to come in reverent appreciation of its significance, and by it show forth the Lord's death until he comes. Those who have faith in Christ and love for the saints are invited in this moment to participate and to do this as often as possible. I ask that as you would hold the elements and we'll receive them together. Welcome to use the altar once you receive the elements, if you'd like to. You're welcome to sing with this song, if you'd like to. This is a very meaningful song to me. I may just burst out in song. Part is very meaningful to me. He is a loving God. And he's been so good to me. And so good to you. And he deserves all our praise. Deserves all our obedience.
You've been so, so good to me.
Sing it with me.
You've been so, so good to me. To think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. You've been so, so good to me. You've been so, so good to me. Oh, to think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. So, so good to me. You've been so, so good to me. Cause you think where I would be if not for you, if not for you. As far as heights reach from the depths, as far as east is from the west, so far your grace has carried. Till I see you face to face, till the last I've won my race. Remind me you're not finished yet. Hallelujah. 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 Live in remembrance.
Reminded that in the same night that our Lord was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." So, Father, we come before you now in true humility and faith, receiving this holy sacrament through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grace and peace to you from him who is, who was, who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who's a faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and has made us to be kingdom and priest to serve his God and Father. To him be the glory and power forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. You go in peace this morning. Go in peace.